What if I told you that a single piece of code changed warfare forever? A weapon with no explosion, no visible damage, but capable of sabotaging a nation's nuclear program. Welcome back to Tech Sky. Today we're analyzing the most sophisticated cyber weapon ever deployed, Stuxnet. Introduction. In 2010, cybersecurity researchers discovered something unprecedented. A malware so advanced, so precisely targeted, that it could only have been created by nation-state actors with virtually unlimited resources. This wasn't just another virus. This was Stuxnet, widely considered the world's first true cyber weapon. In today's video, we'll dissect this revolutionary malware from both technical and strategic perspectives. We'll explore how it worked, why it was revolutionary, and the profound implications it has for the future of cyber warfare. Whether you're a cybersecurity professional or simply fascinated by the intersection of technology and geopolitics, this analysis will give you unprecedented insight into one of the most significant cyber events in history. Section 1, the target and objective. To understand Stuxnet's brilliance, we first need to understand its target. Iran's uranium enrichment facility at Natanz. Enriching uranium requires thousands of centrifuges operating in precise harmony. These machines spin at supersonic speeds, separating uranium isotopes through minute differences in their atomic weight. The centrifuges at Natanz were controlled by Siemens S7315 programmable logic controllers, PLCs, specialized industrial computers designed to control physical processes. Here's why this matters. These systems were air-gapped, completely disconnected from the internet. Conventional wisdom said they were unhackable. Stuxnet's objective wasn't just to crash computers or steal data. Its mission was to physically destroy uranium centrifuges while hiding the sabotage from human operators. This wasn't just hacking, this was physical sabotage through digital means. Section 2, the unprecedented complexity. What made Stuxnet extraordinary was its technical sophistication. Let's break down its key components. Stuxnet leveraged 4 zero-day exploits, previously unknown vulnerabilities with no existing patches. To put this in perspective, 0 days are the crown jewels of hacking. They're extremely valuable and rarely used. Most attacks use known vulnerabilities. Using 4 in a single piece of malware was unprecedented and immediately signaled the work of an extremely sophisticated actor. The malware contained the first ever PLC rootkit. This groundbreaking component allowed it to inject code into industrial controllers while hiding those changes from operators, making the sabotage virtually invisible to even vigilant personnel. Stuxnet also used stolen digital certificates from reputable companies like Realtek and JMicron. This gave it the appearance of legitimate software, allowing it to bypass security measures that would typically flag unsigned code as potentially malicious. Perhaps most impressively, it contained a sophisticated command and control system that allowed its creators to update the malware and receive data from infected systems, despite their isolation from the internet, a feat that challenged conventional security assumptions. The code itself was approximately 500 kilobytes, enormous for malware at that time, and contained about 15,000 lines of code across multiple modules, each with specific functions.
The modularity itself showed exceptional software engineering principles. This wasn't the work of ordinary hackers.
Security experts estimate it would have required a team of at least 30 specialists working for 6 months at a cost of millions of dollars. The resources, coordination, and testing required pointed to only one possible source: nation states with advanced cyber capabilities. Section 3, the attack vector, jumping the air gap. How do you infect a system that's completely disconnected from the internet? This is where Stuxnet's brilliance really shines. The attack began with infected USB drives. The creators understood human behavior. They knew engineers and contractors regularly connected USB drives to both internet-connected computers and the isolated systems at Natanz. Once a USB drive was plugged into a Windows computer, Stuxnet would immediately exploit the Windows .lnk vulnerability, a flaw in how Windows processed shortcut files. Simply viewing the contents of the USB drive in File Explorer was enough to trigger the infection. No clicking required. But the true genius was Stuxnet's selective targeting. It contained a complex fingerprinting mechanism that checked if it was on the right system. If it found itself on an ordinary computer, it would remain dormant, only replicating to USB devices. But when it detected the specific Siemens software used to program PLCs, it activated its payload. This extreme specificity is why millions of computers were infected worldwide, but only the centrifuges at Natanz were actually damaged.
Section 4, the sabotage mechanism. Once Stuxnet found its target, it executed one of the most sophisticated attacks ever seen. First, it identified the specific frequency converters controlling the centrifuges. These had to be made by specific manufacturers, either Vecon from Finland or Ferraro Paya from Iran. Then, it monitored the centrifuges operating at their normal frequency of 1,064 Hz, the exact speed needed for uranium enrichment. When the conditions were perfect, Stuxnet would periodically alter the frequency of the centrifuges, first dramatically increasing their speed to 1,410 Hz for 15 minutes, then reducing it to a low of 2 Hz for another 15 minutes. These wild variations put enormous physical stress on the centrifuge's delicate mechanical components, causing them to break down prematurely. But here's the truly ingenious part. While this was happening, Stuxnet would record normal readings from the sensors and play them back to the operators, like a thief replacing security camera footage with a loop of empty hallway. The operators saw only normal readings on their monitors, even as their centrifuges were tearing themselves apart. This wasn't just a hack. It was industrial sabotage through digital deception at a level never seen before. Section 5, the discovery and attribution. Stuxnet operated undetected for over a year before being discovered, and even then, it was found almost by accident. In June 2010, a small security firm in Belarus was investigating computers in Iran that kept crashing and rebooting. What they found would shock the cybersecurity world. The investigation was led by researchers from Kaspersky Lab, Symantec, and other security firms. As they decompiled the code, they were stunned by its complexity and clear purpose. While no nation has officially claimed responsibility for Stuxnet, forensic evidence within the code and subsequent investigative reporting point to a joint U.S.-Israeli operation codenamed Olympic Games, started under President George W. Bush and accelerated under President Barack Obama. The clues were subtle but revealing. The name Myrtis appeared in the code, possibly referencing the biblical story of Esther, who saved the Jews from the Persians, modern-day Iranians. Specific date checks in the code aligned with significant Israeli and Iranian political events. The resources required matched only what major nation-states could provide, narrowing the list of possible creators significantly. What was most revealing, however, was the impact. Iran admitted that its nuclear program had suffered setbacks, and analysis showed that nearly 1,000 centrifuges at Natanz were destroyed. The precision of the attack pointed to actors with deep intelligence about Iran's nuclear program. What was most revealing, however, was the impact. Iran admitted that its nuclear program had suffered setbacks, and analysis showed that nearly 1,000 centrifuges at Natanz were destroyed. The precision of the attack pointed to actors with deep intelligence about Iran's nuclear program. Section 6, the legacy and implications. Stuxnet forever changed cybersecurity and warfare. Let's examine its lasting impact. First, it demonstrated that digital attacks could cause physical destruction. Before Stuxnet, cyber attacks were largely limited to data theft or service disruption. Now, critical infrastructure, power grids, water systems, transportation networks, are recognized as vulnerable to digital weapons. This realization fundamentally changed risk assessments worldwide. Second, it triggered an arms race in cyber capabilities. Nations around the world accelerated their offensive and defensive cyber programs. Today, over 30 countries have formal military cyber units, with annual budgets collectively reaching into the billions of dollars. What was once the domain of hackers became a strategic military priority almost overnight. Third, it exposed the vulnerability of industrial control systems. Before Stuxnet, security for these systems was an afterthought, with many deployed decades ago when network threats weren't a consideration. Now, industrial cybersecurity is a multi-billion dollar industry, with specialized firms dedicated to protecting critical infrastructure. Fourth, it revealed the strategic advantage of cyber operations. Compared to conventional military action, Stuxnet was deniable, providing plausible deniability for its creators. It was precise, targeting only specific systems rather than causing widespread damage. It was bloodless, causing no direct human casualties that might trigger international outrage. It proved cost-effective, requiring far less investment than military strikes. And it was less escalatory, avoiding the overt acts of war that might have provoked a conventional military response. Most importantly, Stuxnet marked the beginning of a new era, one where code can be weaponized and deployed across borders with profound real-world consequences. Section 7, technical lessons for cybersecurity professionals. What can today's cybersecurity professionals learn from Stuxnet? First, air gaps are not impenetrable. Stuxnet proved that no system is truly isolated if humans interact with it. Social engineering and supply chain attacks can bypass even the most stringent physical security measures. The belief in absolute security through physical isolation was shattered forever. Second, defense in depth is essential. Stuxnet succeeded because it exploited vulnerabilities at multiple levels. From the USB drivers, to the Windows operating system, to the Siemens software, to the PLC firmware. A single layer of protection, no matter how strong, will eventually fail. Only overlapping defenses can provide meaningful security against sophisticated threats. Third, legitimate credentials remain a powerful attack vector. Stuxnet's use of stolen digital certificates highlights why strong certificate management and code signing practices are crucial. When malware appears legitimate to security systems, traditional defenses become nearly useless. The integrity of authentication systems themselves must be rigorously protected. Fourth, sophisticated threats don't announce themselves. Stuxnet was designed to operate silently, making subtle changes that appeared as ordinary equipment failures. This underscores the importance of comprehensive monitoring that can detect anomalous behavior patterns, not just known threats. Security teams must look for deviations from normal operations, not just recognized malware signatures. Finally, never underestimate the resourcefulness of determined adversaries. If a target is valuable enough, attackers will invest extraordinary resources to compromise it. The level of effort that went into Stuxnet demonstrates that conventional risk calculations often underestimate the lengths to which motivated attackers will go to achieve their objectives. Conclusion. Stuxnet represents a watershed moment in the history of cybersecurity and warfare. It demonstrated that the digital and physical worlds are not separate domains, but deeply interconnected. The sophistication of Stuxnet may seem beyond the capabilities of ordinary attackers, but its techniques have been studied, adapted, and in some cases replicated in the years since its discovery. The code has been decompiled and analyzed, becoming a blueprint for future attacks. Whether you view Stuxnet as a legitimate act of national security or a dangerous escalation in warfare, one thing is certain. It changed the rules of the game. The digital domain is now firmly established as the fifth battle space, alongside land, sea, air, and space. As we continue to build our modern society on a foundation of interconnected systems, the lessons of Stuxnet remain as relevant as ever. Call to action. If you found this analysis of Stuxnet insightful, hit that like button and subscribe for more deep dives into significant cybersecurity events and technologies. What aspect of Stuxnet did you find most fascinating? Let me know in the comments below. If there's another major cyber incident or technology you'd like me to analyze in a future video, drop your suggestions in the comments. As always, stay curious, stay ethical, and keep learning. Tech Sky signing off.